Appropriation Bill 2014. Thank you. Mr. Yu Siwing. Thank you, Mr. Deputy. The theme of the budget this year is competitiveness. China is now the second largest economy in the world. And in the United States and Europe, the economy has yet to recover. So we have to see in Hong Kong where we have advantages and where we have inadequacies. How could we adjust to the new circumstances? How can Hong Kong stay as a competitive city? So these are issues we have to ponder. We want to enhance our own competitiveness, but before we do that, we have to know ourselves well. Hong Kong is a compact place with a high population density. We do not have much human natural resources. There are constraints on our development. Over the years, Hong Kong succeeded because of our entrepreneurial spirit, and we have rule of law. We also have free flow of information. At the same time, we have benefited from the economic development of the mainland and favorable policies towards us. That's why Hong Kong was able to play its role in the international arena. Hong Kong wants to maintain its development. It has to enhance its own competitiveness. We must also make use of our advantage. Now, for example, last year, we received 54.3 million visitors, 75% were from mainland, 25% were from overseas. For overseas long-haul visitors, that was just 8%. On various occasions, we heard that we'd like to boost the ratio of overseas visitors, especially those from Europe and the United States. But then in Hong Kong, when it comes to tourism resources, we just have the Disneyland and Ocean Park. These are tourist attractions bountiful in other places as well. If we just rely on the East meets West cultural or Chinese culinary appeal, people won't come to Hong Kong. They won't stay long either. Perhaps we could join hands with Macau and major cities in the Guangdong province, so we could promote multi-destinations itinerary. And then the Hong Kong-Zhuhai-Macau bridge and the express rail link will be completed soon, and that will make Hong Kong more appealing, especially to long-haul visitors from Europe and the United States. Now, we want Hong Kong to develop further, then we must not just rely on ourselves. We have to seize upon opportunities around us in neighboring areas, and then we could stay strong in the international arena. If we adopt a closed mind and we refuse to cooperate with others, then there's no way we could thrive. Now, there's been an assessment report on our reception capacity. There's a substantial surge in the number of mainland visitors, but then in that assessment, we do not see what concrete measures there are to stream visitors. CE has recently announced a study we've done on our reception capacity. Now, apart from doing the assessment, we should also provide more resources for residents, residential areas or tourist areas where local residents are affected. We should do in-depth studies. We have to look at the shopping patterns of visitors, their choice of transport and so on. And then we could take a targeted approach to find a solution to the problem. And then we could do a proper job in streaming visitors. In any case, Hong Kong is a welcoming host. We should provide happy, comfortable, and convenient environment to visitors. We mustn't give the impression that we discriminate against visitors and we try to screen visitors. But then there are many people in Hong Kong who have different views because of the large number of mainland visitors in Hong Kong. I'm a local Hong Konger. I fully appreciate when there's an over-concentration of mainland visitors in certain areas, it would cause nuisance and inconvenience to local residents. That's why I have said this many times, together with the other members of the sector. We went to Tokawan, Hong Hum, Repulse Bay, or the Lok Ma Chau boundary control point to try to look at the actual situation and see whether we could come up with solutions. With the support of government departments, we have now achieved some results. As a representative of the tourism sector, I also have the duty to explain to members of the public the contribution of tourism to our economy. We should analyze some facts objectively, and we should lay out the pros and cons so that all parties could join hands to come find solutions.
Recently, some of the radical people in the community are blaming the individual visit schemes for our problems, such as cloudiness, and they have taken irrational measures against tourists. They harass the tourists and greatly tarnish our image as a tourism attraction. Although we know that they represent only a small minority and by no means the majority, but our reputation as a civilized destination has been affected. I hope these people will think twice before they do this again. Mr. Deputy, tourism is a pillar industry in Hong Kong. However, the government hasn't taken a lot of measures to support tourism. This year's budget refers to some plans to expand tourism. And among the measures to be taken, there will be six sites in Kai Tak for the construction of hotels. In 2 to 3 years, $45 million and $50 million will be given to the Hong Kong Tourism Board to attract MICE tourists and also to organize more mega events, sports events, and there will be a 3D display show so as to attract more tourists. These are pragmatic measures. I hope the government will continue to invest more in promoting tourism. As for the artificial island, to tie in with the Hong Kong Zhuhai Macau Bridge, we haven't got concrete plans, but lately there's a proposal to make use of the underground space there. So the bridgehead economy has taken the very first step. And $60 million have been earmarked in the budget for research. This is most welcome, but it's also a belated effort. If we start right away from the, we can only expect the commissioning day to be after 2016, and that is after the completion of the bridge. So some tourists will be lost to Hengqin and Macau. Whether we can recover the lost ground is unknown. I hope the government can learn a lesson and will not make the same mistake again. Mr. Deputy, this year's budget has done a moderately good job in implementing the measures announced in the policy address. In terms of promotion of industries and care for the elderly and investment in training and our people and our workforce, some measures have been proposed and we should give credit to them. But there's no increase in the investment in infrastructure. The government should make suitable adjustments in due course to meet the public demand. The biggest selling point of the budget is on land planning. For a very long time, land supply is lagging behind. Property prices are high. In this year's land sale program, the supply will be increased significantly so that we can provide 15,500 residential units, the highest in more than 10 years. In the medium to long term, for the coming 5 years, under the budget's proposals, $650 million will be given to bureaus to strengthen the planning on provision of sites. And also, the government is also going full steam ahead for Northeast Anti, Lok Ma Chau, and Hong Sui Kiu. And also, they are going to have land reclamation for East Lantau Metropolis, the artificial island project, and so that we can alleviate the land shortage problem. And that will also lay a sound foundation for future economic development. A lot of job opportunities can be created. I hope the government would implement what he has promised. Mr. Deputy, when the budget was announced, people were very concerned about whether their aspirations have been met and what areas in the project would be of their concern. In recent years, the government has launched for a period of 7 years the handing out of so-called sweeteners. People have been accustomed to this. This year, we have got fewer sweeteners, and the government has also sounded a warning that in 7 years' time, the soonest, we are going to have a structural deficit problem. The community has criticized and commented on the philosophy of fiscal planning. Many people brush aside the advance warning from the government. According to these people, there are great fiscal reserve in the hands of the government. If they're invested wisely, that there will be no deficit problem. And they're saying that the government is over-worried about the problems. And the problems that we are facing is lack of human resources, aging population, and lack of land resources. These are the biggest risk factors that we face. Among them, the biggest risk factor is the aging population, which can lead to a decline in our workforce, affecting our revenue and competitiveness. Even if the economy is booming, if we do not have sufficient manpower to support its development, there is no resources to support social projects, and we will not be able to avoid a structural deficit. And then the government, the finances will be mired in difficulties. In 1992, the government debt of Japan, it was only 66.5% of its GDP. It was 230% last year. Within a period of 20 years, the new debts accounted for more than 100% of its GDP. It was mainly due to the aging population. If we are to promote the welfare of our future generation, I hope the government will continue to manage our finances prudently. The government is going to set up a long-term working group on long-term fiscal planning, so that we can assess whether the expenditure is incurred with social benefits. This is a responsible manner. We have many deep-rooted financial problems which cannot be resolved overnight. Some members have given advance warning that they are going to embark on a filibustering exercise because their wishes have not been met. I want to advise these people that this will only lead to more social grievances. This is not productive. I hope they will not do something unwise which benefit no one. With this remark, I support the 2014-15 budget. Mr. Chen Kam-lam. Mr. Deputy, in 2013, well, the global economy was described as being out of the tunnel, but no light was seen yet. Although the winter of economic downturn has passed, the economic situation in the US, in Europe, and Japan are still facing a bleak future. The recovery is still weak. Although the FS mentions in the budget that this year the revenue that we are going to generate is lower than expected, and therefore fewer sweeteners can be handed out. But still, in the context of the global climate, this is the encouraging. We have registered 2.9% in GDP. The service export, 5.8% in growth was registered. So it's an important sector for our economy. Local consumption and consumption by tour visitors were strong, lending support to the retail sector. The volume of sales increased by 11.11% over the previous year. And in June 2014, there was an increase of 14.5% year on year. The labor market has been tight. In the first 3 months since 2012, the unemployment rate, which is seasonally adjusted, was 3.1%, the lowest in 16 years. Our economic performance is due to our close relationship with the mainland economy. The mainland's growth is the major growth engine for our economy. This is not difficult to tell. The only economy which has been growing steadily after the latest economic financial crisis has been China. Our SEPA and other cooperation with the mainland has brought about a lot of benefits to our economy. After the reunification, the CPG has launched a lot of measures to help Hong Kong cope with difficulties, including SEPA, the introduction of IVS, the opening up of renminbi business, a lot of IPOs of mainland enterprises, and the promotion of PRD and cooperation with Guangdong, and the implementation of infrastructure projects and another 36 strategic measures to help Hong Kong. These have played an instrumental role in helping Hong Kong and promoting Hong Kong's economy. This illustrates the care shown by the CBG towards Hong Kong. In 2013, because of SARS, the economy took a dip. According to some economists, the newly introduced IVS saved Hong Kong. Tourists from other countries were still hesitant to visit Hong Kong at that time, but a lot of mainland visitors did come, and our tourism industry boomed, leading to a lot of business for other related sectors. In 2011, under the IVS, which was introduced under SEPA, created 54,000 jobs for Hong Kong, and the enterprises gained a lot from the arrival of visitors. IVS has given a big boost to our economy. Recently, because of parallel great good traders causing congestion in Fanling, and many people have asked for restriction to be placed on mainland visitors. This is irrational and unwise. Any restriction on IVS will affect tens of thousands of SMEs and hundreds of thousands of employees. What we should do is to enhance our capacity, expand our tourism industries, and DAB suggests that we should make adjustments, increase our capacity to receive more visitors. Our GDP has grown by 56% since 2003. The annual growth rate is 5.1%. We outpace the growth rate in the US, Europe, and Japan. And goods trading in goods has been developing very quickly. As at the end of 2013, under the SEPA arrangement, the value of goods that have been benefited from the SEPA arrangements has been more than $7 billion, and there's been a tenfold increase for goods exported to the mainland. And our manufacturing industries have benefited a lot. Many famous brands on the mainland are Hong Kong brands, or the goods are manufactured in Hong Kong. And the share of our service industry is getting bigger and bigger. The mainland has introduced 403 liberalization measures, for our service industry. So, and 140 items have been covered.
93.1% of the WTO sectors, and the service income from SIPA rose from $1.5 billion in 2004 to 2009, nearly $69 billion. That accounted for a rising percentage of service income from the mainland. As in, as at the end of 2009, there has been a rapid growth of professional service provided by Hong Kongers to the mainland. For many businesses, the turnover in the mainland are more than those in Hong Kong, and professionals and institutions have more business opportunities in the mainland. Professionals have more job opportunities in the mainland. They are making additional incomes in terms of billions and billions of dollars. So the mainland is very important to the professionals in Hong Kong. As for SIPA, it provides opportunities for the legal services, financial services, testing and certification, and audiovisual and telecommunication industries. The trades continue to enhance cooperation in terms of investment, financial services. The financial services and banking industry are also benefited by SIPA. There is lowering of the threshold for starting branches in the mainland, and also the restriction on duration of service, and also setting up of branches outside within Guangdong, and expanding the network. Hong Kong local banks have established 9 corporate banks and 400 branches in the mainland, accounting for 2/3 of the foreign banks and branches in the mainland. Since the signing of SIPA in the past 11 years, Hong Kong is steadily moving upwards. The economy is developing, there has been a substantial change in relation between Hong Kong and the mainland. If we continue to have better planning in our industries and formulate our industrial policy, then we'll continue to grow. Taiwan, the students oppose the ECFA, or rather the service agreement, and they said that today's Hong Kong is the future of Taiwan. Hong Kong is dead, and Taiwan should learn from this. And there are people in Hong Kong who engage in hunger strike to support Taiwan students. They are not able to see the benefits of, in fact, though they are able to see the benefits of opening up service industries in China to Hong Kong, they are trying to fan fire. In fact, SIPA is an opportunity for Hong Kong, and many countries want to have that treatment. Over the years, over 10 years, the mainland has given a lot of benefits to Hong Kong professionals and Hong Kong enterprises, and they have a lot of good opportunities, investment opportunities in the mainland. Other countries are just envy of us. The opposition tried to smear the policy of the mainland towards Hong Kong. This is not the first time they smear the 12-5-year plan. They smear that the express rail is also harming Hong Kong. The mainland policies are sugar-coated poison, and they say mainland visitors are locusts. The opposition tried to smear mainland policies which support Hong Kong. They just want to cast divisions between Hong Kong and the mainland. They want to scaremonger us that Hong Kong will turn red, and they try to undermine the reputation of the SARG and the mainland government. Today's Hong Kong, the future Taiwan, is not a warning but an encouragement. Hong Kong should be the target for Taiwan's endeavors. Now, we are called the Four Little Dragons, Taiwan is lagging. Taiwan's economy is lagging behind Hong Kong and Singapore. Its openness in terms of economy is less than that of Singapore, Hong Kong. If Taiwan can solve the problem of service trade agreement, then its GDP can grow by 35%, and they will have a growth of more than $120 billion. If they reject the service trade agreement, Taiwan will suffer economic depression, and they will lose 100,000 billions of $100 billion. Taiwan will be trailing behind, far behind Hong Kong. Economic integration is the world trend. Hong Kong should be warned against this complacency, and should be warned against closing its borders to the mainland. Today's Hong Kong, the future Taiwan. The future of Taiwan, we should worry, is that today's Taiwan, the future of Hong Kong. A trade agreement is an economic issue, but those with ulterior motives escalated to become a political movement. We should be warned that this is irrational, this damaged democratic process, paralyzing the government. This kind of Taiwanese democracy is something we should guard against. The Democrats are going to cause financial crisis by filibustering. That's a warning to us. The opposition send people to Taiwan, watch the sunflower policy, learn sunflower campaign, learn the lessons. They try to make use of radical popular movement to damage political social stability. That is really dangerous. The pan-democrats say, without democracy, there is no governance. When there is democracy, then there is mandate. Let us look at what it is in Taiwan, what it is in Thailand. You know that democracy is not the panacea for solving social problems. If you ask Ma Ying-jeou or Enoch, you will get an answer. With democracy, it's still difficult to govern. Said by Professor Lui, in a torn society, democracy cannot operate well. Those who lost in the election will try every means to make governance difficult for the winner, and that's the true picture of democracy. Thank you. Miss Priscilla Leung. Mr. President, if you don't look at the long term, you will not be successful. If you don't look at, you don't have a comprehensive view, you don't have your policy right. The budget has to have long term and short term consideration. In the long term, it's just like Chinese medicine. It strengthens your immunity system. It makes you healthy. And we also need to have short-term measures. It's just like using Western medicine. It can cure immediate problems, but certain measures cannot be used too frequently. Say, for example, tax increase. If you use it too often, that will have an adverse impact on the market. We have to consider the short-term and long-term targets of the budget. I want to put my question to the FS. Probably he's having his meal. I remember last year he was having a meal at similar time. I put the same question to him. He has been the FS for 7 years. What does he want people to remember him of? Henry Tang is to put an end to deficits, and Donald Zhang is to combat the financial tycoons, and then financial speculators, beg pardon, and then Lady Tai Church is to combat the trade unions, and the FS. What does he want people to remember him for? Now he has not encountered great troubles. He should try to achieve realistic targets. I just want to mention three visions, though they are small. I hope he can achieve that, and that is the ratio of the middle class will increase from 30% to 50% in the long term, at least in the coming a few years, all policy should work towards this. And what does it mean? First of all, is to prevent the downward mobility of the middle class. They will not be rendered no property, or they will not be able to maintain their present standard of living, and they fall outside the definition of the middle class, and they have to rely on CSSA. This will only enhance the burden on the community, and that is also not good for those affected. The second objective should help those who get out of poverty and become middle income. Now we can compare certain numbers. In Hong Kong, about 30% belong to the middle income group. The UK, 46%, US, 51%, South Korea, 53%. That is, in other words, the proportion of our middle income people is rather low. The middle class means stability for the community. The middle class is to feed the elderly and their children. They rely on themselves. They pay tax. They seldom get social benefits. Increasing the number of the middle class will be beneficial to our society in every respect. According to our fiscal reserves, according to our budget, a recurrent expenditure, $22.3 billion. And in the future, there will be consolidated surplus of $9.1 billion. How should we spend so much money? Now, everything should be targeted at this goal. The second vision is healthcare. I've argued with members that capitalism is proved to be not workable, in particular with regard to the Lehman Brothers. I have hesitation towards any revolutionary change, and we have to observe Article 118 and 117 of the Basic Law. We do not implement socialism. We have to maintain capitalism for 50 years and change, balanced budgets, low-tax policy. We have to make sure that under one country, two systems, we continue to develop the capitalist economy. And in terms of political development, one requirement is to maintain a political system that facilitates development of capitalism. We have to consider how to make money and how to spend money. And a very important issue is aging population. In 2014, one in three is an elderly. One in eight is an old age elderly, i.e. above age 80. With regard to public health care, and also the public health care bill and the private health care bill, they are very important. And the health care bill is one of the reasons for turning a middle class into a person with no property. And upon one's retirement, at least half of one's savings is spent on health care. With such a huge health bill, can Hong Kong continue to spend? Let us look at our social welfare. Last year, 13.9% of the budget. This year, 15.1% of the budget. That is on the low side, relatively speaking. And I think we can be more focused and more wiser in social welfare. And we should pay more in terms of public health care. There should be overall planning which can help young people to help to pay for health insurance of their parents. And as for the retirees who don't have children, they have to pay out their own pockets to pay for health insurance so as to reduce the burden on the public sector healthcare service. I'm willing to put money into healthcare system, whether it's in terms of manpower, resources, medicine, drug formulary. They are much needed. People have to survive. They need to have good health. They need to be cured.
healthcare spending is predictable. If you go up to 2041, well, the silver hair population, they are consumers, of course. But then the silver hair group may be a new source of workers. They could make their own income, and they could again be active in the community. You know, the so-called elderly people, some are not that old, maybe they retired 55, 60, or even 65, they are still able to work, especially, you know, for people who do not do manual work, who do intellectual work. They could be advisors or consultants. Now, what about schools for Hong Kong children on the mainland, secretary for the education here? So these are the kind of work people could still do at an old age. And I think the government should engage a group of economists to help us here. Now, we could project the long-term spending that's required, like spending on elderly services and healthcare. Now, we can see there's no way we could trim down on such spending, because still the reliance would be on public health care. So how could we turn these services into trade or sector? And then there could be stable income to offset spending. If the FS could do this within his term, he would have done us so much good. And then the third long-term task we have to consider, the FS, I'm saying it is the second time during this the FS term. I hope he will do more to reduce the odor in the Victoria harbors. Now, I've recently written to the Drainage Service Department, Environmental Protection Department, and so on, because where I live, Kowloon West, from Chin Wan all the way to Teng Kau along the waterfront, when we jog there, anytime you can hear this horrible stench. Now, of course, people are saying that I shouldn't just be helping Kowloon East, I should also help New Territories West. That's why I've finally written a complaint to the Revenue Department. Now, we fully support developing our waterfront. For our old, for our young, the waterfront is a nice place to go to do something healthy. But if the air is so poor, you know, Kowloon Southeast, for instance, definitely there will be a bad odor coming from the cruise ships. Because, and then I've heard from Qigong masters and other masters that when the air is so poor, might as well just do your exercise indoor. So that's a waste of invaluable resource. Now, this year, we're told that so much is spent on the harbor area treatment scheme, one, heads two, whatever. But that's not good enough. I hope the AFS will find us more money to clean up our harbor, because everybody will applaud that. And it will be good for our health. It will help to reduce public spending on healthcare as well. Well, perhaps I should also mention here, there are many people who live by the waterfront. Kowloon West, Hong Hom, Wong, Whampoa, Tai Kwok Chue, and so on. You know, ferry services are being scrapped, or fares are going up. I think we should have a policy to support ferry services that ought to be kept as we spend money to develop the waterfront, because ferry services are a collective memory of the people of Hong Kong. It's also a good way to relieve traffic congestion. I hope the government will consider it. So I'm just mentioning it incidentally. Now, Mr. Deputy, I hope the FS will consider three targets. In the near term, in terms of spending on people's livelihood, the government has gone one step further for healthcare vouchers, as the sum has gone up, providing more subsidy to low-income households. More elderly will benefit from the $2 concessionary fare. I support in particular the plan to develop, to promote development among workers or laborers. Now, I know this bone setter. I for a long time, his sons are now grown up. I knew them as a child. And the two sons have graduated. They are blue-collar workers. And after they finished school, they went to work in the construction industry. They became contractors themselves. And they were able to support their family well. So you see, blue-collar workers have good prospects. Now, this young man has only worked about 5-6 years. He's earning $60,000-$70,000 a month. So we should encourage people to take up blue-collar work. They earn good income. It also gives hope to young people. People can stay as workers or they could start their own business. Now, there is this recommendation to set up a future fund. Basing on the land fund. So the fund should find ways to support young people in their schooling and work prospects. There should be more training on for young people on management and so on. And also switching trades for the unemployed. Now there are many in their 40s, 50s, they're not able to switch to different trades when they become unemployed, and they're not even tell friends that they are jobless. So we do something to help them. And then in this budget, there is mention of this pilot arbitration scheme on land premium payment. I think the scheme should be expanded to cover other disputes among people. The grassroots should be allowed to use the arbitration platform as well. For example, disputes involving owners' corporations, mandatory, compulsory attend auction and so on. I hope the government will consider that. Now, I think it's good for the government, for the FS to think about the possible adversities, but we don't want the FS to be dubbed a Scrooge. I hope the FS can show us his work, and there's something for people to remember him about. The first point is about improving the water quality in the Victoria Harbours. Everyone in Hong Kong would thank him for that. And then there should be more means to help the middle class. The third is that there should be ways to new ways to think about spending, you know, how we can spend for our future, for our long term. There should be a systematic approach. At the same time, we could find ways to generate income. And then we could try to turn some of the spending areas into trades and industry where we could make an income. I hope the FS will consider it. I support the budget. I'm against any filibustering. I hope the appropriation bill will be passed soon. Thank you, Mr. Peter Jung. Thank you, Mr. Deputy. Before I talk about the budget this year, I first would like to comment on the report of the Working Group on Long-Term Fiscal Planning, because here in this report, there are the words long-term fiscal and planning, so it's important for Hong Kong. The report proposes to deal separately with our operating account and non-operating account. For operating accounts, expenditure should not exceed 90%, and the expenditure in the non-operating account should not exceed that of the operating account. Now, this is the recommendation of the Working Group on Long-Term Fiscal Planning. That's to reshape the fiscal discipline of the government. But then there was an analysis in Ming Pao. If we adopt that standard, then starting from 1997 to now, there have been so far 17 financial years, and in 10 financial years, fiscal spending exceeds income. Even for this year budget, we cannot keep spending within income. Now, public spending, in a broad sense, welfare spending has been capped because of this concern that it will drive our economy to the ground. So there's been no development on that front. So when the FS quotes from this report, is the social welfare sector believes the government is trying to cap spending on welfare in the broad sense. And then for non-operating spending, it must be paid for by non-operating revenue or financing or borrowings. Now then I'm concerned about small class teaching. 15 years of free education may be, they don't stand a chance. There may be further reduction in healthcare spending, or there might be privatization of healthcare services. There won't be any increase in welfare spending. Now, I support reordering fiscal discipline or reforming fiscal discipline. That gives people hope when you use the word reform. But now the government puts the political motives first when it spends. It's not right. At the same time, the current mechanism is too conservative. Now, maybe under the current conservative, we have stable recurrent expenditures, so we're able to meet the requirements of the basic order spending within our means. And when necessary, there could be financing or borrowing. But for infrastructure projects. But then for welfare spending, for instance, I don't believe the government will borrow to support welfare spending. And so that does not bode well for grassrooters. In fact, they'll be dealt a severe blow if there's no development in the welfare spending front. That would add to the rules of widening wealth gap that will not be good for social stability. So I and the social welfare sector are dead against that. Now, our economy is slanted towards some financial services, tourism, and services industries. But the government should promote research and the development of other high-value-added industries. We shouldn't just focus on a few industries. Now, this budget actually probably takes heed more of the needs of new grassrooters. For example, this year there is the working family allowance. Now, when C.Y. Leung delivered his policy address, he said he's going to spend substantially on poverty relief. That's why the budget will have to support him. For these relief measures, they are real to the grassrooters. But then on the question of the wealth gap, I hope the government will show the responsibility and do more. Last year, the Hong Kong Council on Social Services published a report that there is a further, there's aggravating poverty among the elderly. In the 33.4% of the 65-year-olds or above are poor, considered poor. That means for every three elderly persons, one is in poverty. Now, for the aging population and aggravating poverty systems, we have to tackle them with a systematic approach. We shouldn't just be making small fixes here and there. I hope the government should launch the universal retirement scheme. The government should also think long-term. It must have vision. For example, long-term housing strategy is just about the housing production target in the next 10 years. It may seem to be a long period, but actually given the complexity and importance of the issue and given the need to satisfy the housing needs of the people, that's actually not good enough. Now, the fiscal management philosophy is the same, that is that we focus on economic development, but then we would not we don't care about a secondary distribution of wealth. We don't care about fairness in society. So that means we just don't care about people's livelihood. That still remains a theme of the budget this year. But I'm sure the government knows this. All along it's been said that if the economy does well in Hong Kong, then the general public would benefit from improved standard of living, but it's proven to be wrong. Now, over the years, Hong Kong has seen a vibrant economy. For many years, we remain one of the most competitive cities around the world, but then our wealth gap continues to widen year by year. The Economist's cronyism index shows that Hong Kong remains top on the list. That's the collusion between the government and businesses. So we mustn't, I think the government shouldn't say any further that with economic development, people's livelihood could be improved. It's not true. The trickle-down effect is just a scam. Now, in the budget, one important mention is the future fund. Actually, some years ago, scholars have already come up with proposals to stabilize our public finances, but the government has not taken heed of that. And for several years, government's been spending money on giving out some short-term reliefs or sweeteners. That's a waste of money. But I think the government must tell us exactly how it's going to put surplus in the future fund. We need the details because this is actually a good idea. But I'm worried. The government wants to suppress spending on social services so there's a surplus for putting in the future fund. But then the future fund would become another spoil for the consortium. I'm afraid that might happen.
DFS has proposed that we use the future fund to deal with the structural deficit, but he does not mention any reform to the taxation system. As I've said time and again, the standard tax rate, corporate tax rate, is 16.5%, which is very low compared with international standards. And there are well-paid employees getting the tens of millions of dollars in salary. He will be paying 15%, just like another one who's earning much less. And Mr. Li Ka-shing has earned a big income from property investment, and there's no value added tax. If we increase profits tax by 1 percentage point and we extend the coverage to the dividend and also to the luxury items, we may have a good recurrent revenue without relying too much on land sales. Then we can mitigate the high property price policy, and we'll help more people buying their own homes, and then we can have effective secondary income distribution leading to social fairness. Property prices will be lowered, business environment will be enhanced, SMEs would have more opportunities, and there will be more jobs for everyone. We can regard the aging population problem as a chance to review our taxation system so that we can achieve fairness and do a better job in the redistribution of income. In paragraph 31 of the budget speech, the FS says that the aging population is one of the three constraints faced by us in the development of our economy. And he no longer tries to set a tone for the problems faced by the elderly. And I would say that the angle taken by the government is different from that adopted by the community. We are uncomfortable with how the FS sees the elderly as an issue. They have contributed to our well-being. These elderly people should not become a burden. They should be allowed to lead a decent life. The government should adopt a humanistic and innovative perspective. We should allow the elderly to contribute their talent to our well-being. We are going to $6.919 billion on elderly services, or an increase in 11%. Mostly will be spent on the OAA, the CSA, OALA. Some $600 million will be spent on elderly service, $35 million to be used for buying pages places of elderly homes on the mainland, and 1,700 odd places will be added to the supply, but the waiting list is numbered at 24,000 people. There's a waiting time of 20 months for care and attention home, 6,373 people are on the waiting list. Every year, thousands die before they get a place. The increase in the number of places cannot meet the demand. And the disabled are facing similar problems in waiting for places of residential homes. the government should do more to reduce the burden faced by the families. Measures in this budget have become somewhat routine. For example, the budget announces that for those who are receiving OALA or OAA would get a double allowance, that an extra month of allowance. But what does that mean? To what extent can it help people to alleviate difficulty that they face in life? Or is it just a good excuse to tell people that I've done something? Although social workers know that it's better than nothing, but additional allowance cannot really help them to solving the problems they face. And we are basing the calculation of CSSA on the 1996 standards. Although there have been increases of 1 or 2 percentages to some of the components, it's still far removed from the reality. And paying double CSA or other allowances are not a standard arrangement. Sometimes you have it, sometimes you don't. I hope the government could review the CSSA system, and before that's completed, you should talk to the welfare organizations to come up with a interim monthly supplement. Mr. Deputy, there are many parts of the budget that are related to the economic policies. They are, in my view, just proposals. We should focus on people's livelihood in preparing future budgets. According to the UA, there should be comprehensive planning and policies on housing, healthcare for the elderly. We should allow the elderly to age in place, and there should be a proper planning of outpatient clinics and advocacy of caring culture for the elderly. And there should be more recreational programs for the elderly. We should make the best use of the talents of our elders. Thank you. Mr. Christopher Chong, Mr. Deputy, in this year's budget, the financial secretary spoke on competitiveness. We know our competitiveness is declining. This business sector is very worried. To enhance Hong Kong's competitive edge, I hope the AFS can come up with concrete proposals. But one of the sure ways of doing this or enhancing our competitiveness is to build a third runway ASAP. Back in the 90s, if we did not build our Che-cheung airport, one cannot imagine what situation our economy would be in. Building the third runway can prompt the development of many industries. It's been mentioned that there will be more support for innovative and creative industries. And the proposed IT and Innovation Bureau that would be realized soon. Most people, of course, will create innovative and creative industries, but we can only come to a decision, come to a final will, when details have been announced by the government. If we look at the investment in technology and creative industries, it's only 0.7%, and that includes the subsidy provided to universities. If we compare with developed economies, where they spend 2 to 3% of the GDP on innovation, we are lagging far behind. There's a big gap between us and them. We need to at least invest $30 to $40 billion of dollars annually. That's the appropriate funding level. Can the government do this? The AFS says in paragraph 102 that there will be suitable help to the industries with potential. And the fashion industry is mentioned. Of course, my business colleagues and I myself were thrilled to learn about this. But what concrete measures would there be? The FS doesn't say anything about those. It only talk about suitable, appropriate assistance. I hope more concrete measures can be announced by the government so that industries with potential can be further developed. As at March this year, we have 745 billion dollars in reserve. So the treasury is flooded with water, with money. So in order to chart our long-term economic development, we should spend more. SMEs would like the government to come up with concrete action plan to assist suitable, appropriately some industries. Last month, I moved a motion to promote the return of industries. It was supported by the members across the political spectrum. The government has a duty to promote industrial development. The budget mentions seven measures to help SMEs, such as a loan guarantee, the branding and promotion, productivity enhancement, and so on and so forth. But actually, five of them are the extension of existing policies, such as the SME financing guarantee scheme, the special concessions, Hong Kong Mortgage Corp's microfinance scheme, and there are only two new measures, and that is $15 million will be reserved on a matching basis to support retailers for the use of IT and other technology solutions, and also to promote cloud computing applications among SMEs and providing training to help them so that they can adopt appropriate and affordable IT solutions. SMEs are facing a severe business environment and changes in the global environment. These two measures are simply inadequate. And apart from that, support to the middle class is reduced instead of increased. There was a previous exercise to give the so-called sweeteners to the middle class. Of course, that was well supported. And now sweeteners are confined to the grassroots, but nothing to the middle class. We're not saying that you should give a lot to the middle class, but what about doing more or less the same as last year? There was only a slight adjustment to the tax allowance for parents and grandparents. Waiver concession is just a $1,500 for two quarters. Last year, it was for four quarters. For the middle class, the biggest item of expenditure is children's education and tuition fee. And there's no subsidy for electricity charges now. We want to get more, and we ended up getting less. So the middle class are disappointed. In recent years, but the government kept talking about handing out sweeteners without any mentioning of increasing revenue. If we don't know where to get our revenue, then according to the report published by the Working Group on Long-Term Fiscal Planning, if we continue like this, the soonest that we are going to have a structural deficit problem is in 7 years' time. And also in 2028, all the reserves will be depleted. with an aging population and a declining workforce, and we have no proper planning for our economy, I just can't see how the government can increase its revenue. So it's likely, it's possible that we are going to have a structural deficit problem some years down the road. But the report doesn't mention how we can increase our revenue. It's only proposed that we turn the land fund with $220 billion into a future fund so that we can generate income from the fund. But I don't quite understand the arrangement. It's just the fund is just given a different name, and who is going to manage it?
Yes, of course, the HKMA. If it is managed by the HKMA, why you say this is XX fund, this is YY fund, and so on and so forth? The administration should enhance Hong Kong's competitiveness and try to drive our economy forward. If the government doesn't do it, then we will not be able to solve this problem, financial deficits. We have fiscal reserves of $770 billion and over, say, 2,000 billion dollars of the exchange money. We have more than or about 3,000 billion dollars, and we should make good use of our money. As for the expenditure by the administration, there's a serious problem with over expenditure of large-scale financial infrastructure projects. There has been substantial exceedance of budget, and supplementary funding has to be sought from this council. They have wasted billions of dollars. The administration should be a good gatekeeper in respect of infrastructure projects and improve the tendering process, reduce delay. If there is shortage of manpower leading to the restriction or constraints on progress, then there should be importation of labor to make sure the projects are completed on time so as to avoid overspending. Overspending is in the range of billions of dollars or tens of billions of dollars. If these amounts can be saved, then they can be spent in other areas, in, say, education, healthcare, social welfare, and other expenses. The overspending should be something the administration should pay attention to. Next, Mr. K.K. Fong.
Thank you, Chairman. I want to spell out more clearly that the CE is really not trustworthy. His fiscal principles are not worth trusting. He is just repeating his old tune. There is nothing new. If you look at today's budget and compare that with last year, apart from cutting certain relief measures, is there any big difference? If you compare this budget with the last budget of Donald Deng's year, was there any difference? 80% of them are the same. Now, there is a change of the CE, but there is no change of the FS. If you compare Donald Deng, the manifesto of Donald Deng, and the manifesto of CY Leung, their manifestos were different. But why the budget or the budgets are the same? Is the FS following the previous CE Donald Deng or the current CE CY Leung? Mr. President, the FS is doing small, the CS is, the FS is scaremongering. He said that after 15 years, there will be 2 million elderly people. The increase in number of elderly will increase the burden on the healthcare bill. There will be structural deficits. There is a need to set up a future fund. But the future fund is not set up for the elderly. The future fund is not to deal with protection, retirement protection
of the people of Hong Kong is not about comprehensive retirement protection. The future fund is to pay for future infrastructure projects. He has pointed out problem of aging population. He has proposed set up a future fund. Why can't he use it to help the retirement protection of the people of Hong Kong? The FAS just put the blame of the future problems on the elderly. The elderly of today, in comparison to the elderly of the previous 10 years, are more capable of planning for their retirement. The FAS has also ignored the fact that more and more elderly in the coming 10 years are professionals, and they are more able to take care of their retirement. The elderly may not be a burden. They may be a new group of powerful consumers. They may provide new opportunities for our economy. The FS should consider the financial profile of the future retirees and plan for new industries. At present, the elderly has become the blame, the scapegoat. Some also criticize the working group for underestimating the investment return of our assets. Even Mr. Lau Wang Fat, the big brother of the establishment, says that the FS has made mistake in his one-year estimate, and how can he make a correct estimate for the coming 7 years? The FS has kept the spending, but he has not created wealth for the community. Since he has been the FS, according to history, according to his track record, he set expenditure below 20% of GDP. To maintain this 20% cap in the past 7 years, even if there has been an average surplus of $50 billion, he doesn't spend it on new industries. We have asked the administration to promote green economy, to promote art and creative industry, set up IT industry. He has not done so. Apart from financial services industry and property development, there should be more new industries to strengthen Hong Kong. But he has not done that. Our fiscal reserves, as you all know, reached 745.9 billion dollars. That has not included the accumulated surpluses of $637.3 billion. At a special FC meeting, the secretary for FST told us in an exuberant spirit that we had 28 months of fiscal reserves since 1998, and he wanted to move the target from 22 months of reserves to 22 months of expenditure to 28 months of expenditure. I don't know why he mentioned that 28 months. You might have forgotten that when Anthony Leung was the FS, he had a long discussion with the council, and our consensus was fiscal reserves should be equivalent to 12 months of government expenditure, i.e., even if there was not a cent of revenue received by the government, the reserves are able to maintain our government for 12 months. Have we discussed 22 months? Have we discussed the period of 28 months? Is it your target, the FS or the SFT? Have you raised your hope too high, raised your target too high? Are you just mindful about money? Have you considered the living conditions of the low-income people? Mr. President, the second point on which the FS is not trustworthy is about his estimates. In the past 7 years, he has never made it correct in his estimates. The difference is from tens of billions of dollars to more than $100 billion. Accumulated surplus during his term, more than $350 billion, half of the total reserves, total fiscal reserves. Now, according to estimate, for the coming year,
2014-15 is another cry wolf. Let's look at numbers. In 2013, first 9 months, surplus $40 billion, final account $64 billion. 2013-14, in the first 9 months, surplus $31.4 billion, and the final accounts, surplus of $12 billion. Why in the first 9 months, the difference was only $8.6 billion? But in the final accounts, the difference was $52.8 billion in the coming 3 months. In the last 3 months, what made the number rise? And in the previous quarter, what made the number decline? There was no explanation. The SFT is here. Probably he knows that one day before the budget, the two pieces of land in Kai Tak rake in $10 billion. When you wrote the budget, you were not so capable as to know you got an additional $10 billion. So I can guess once again that your estimate is once again wrong. The surplus, I believe, will certainly be more than $12 billion. Under such circumstances, how can I trust you? You have this budget in your hand. 7 years in a row, the estimate has not been correct. How can it be correct this year? And even kindergarten, or rather, even primary school students know the story of Cry Wolf. And we cannot just close in our eyes and trust you. The third aspect in which the FS is not trustworthy is the relief measure is not trustworthy. Now, after all these relief measures, there is a surplus of $12 billion and a cumulative surplus of $745.9 billion, excluding the huge exchange fund. As at the end of 2012-13, total asset is $3,300 billion. That's the financial strength of the SARG. One-off relief measures benefit the middle class and the grassroots, and it is necessary, and it is also within the capability of the administration. Yet the administration goes against this and take away a lot of relief measures, such as electricity tariff, which benefit everybody. The administration just waived two quarters of rates and waived 1 month of public housing rents. Though the FS proposes set up the future fund, it's only to make sure that infrastructure can be implemented during a tight budget years. But for long-term welfare policies like retirement protection, not a word has been spoken. How can we develop humanity industries? How can we establish platforms to enable different industries to develop and build a new Hong Kong? Nothing has been said on this. All in all, he has adopted the tactic of Cry Wolf. He continue to be the Mr. Scrooge and uphold his miserly principles. And he also made use of the report of the Working Group on Long-Term Financial Fiscal Planning and scare us with a possible deficit in 7 years' time so that people are scared into supporting the principle of keeping government spending less than 20% of GDP instead of letting Hong Kong people to have a better life. Mr. President, I also want to point out finally that the FS has made another mistake in his estimates. When he forecasts future revenue, there will be an income of $70 billion from land sales. In this year, the income was $80 billion, but that was still unable to meet the production target of 20,000 units in the private sector. The Secretary for Development said that he would spare no effort in getting land to build homes. The sale of land in the coming year will be more than 20,000 units equivalent in the private sector. If there can be more than 20,000 units, why the income from land sales will be less than $80 billion? Because this year we have $80 billion from land sales and we built less than 20,000 units. So the FS is not trustworthy. Mr. President.
Let's see what the public response was after the delivery of the budget. The Hong Kong University POP program, the public opinion program, the survey found that the average score is 48%, 1% lower than before the delivery. But compared to the second round of survey, there's some slight increase of 0.3 points. Now, 22% are happy, 44% are not happy. That's more or less the same as the first round of survey findings. From the and also, over 1,000 interviewees were interviewed. 61% of those interviewed believed that FS did not offer enough relief measures. Only 33% thought they were enough. There's another survey, a Hong Kong Survey Association published its findings in March. It interviewed 1,600 also interviewees. 32% were not happy with the budget, an increase of 5% compared to last year. Only 26% were happy, a drop of 2%. So that we see that the rating of this budget is worse than in past years. Now, the government deliberately tried to reduce number of sweeteners in the budget. 56% of those surveyed believed there were too few relief measures, an increase of 3% over last year. Only 23% thought they were sufficient. 16% thought the relief measures were excessive, and some said there was no need. And actually, some queried that the budget was favoring grassroots and ignoring the middle class. And that's a warning. There's also the working group on the long-term fiscal planning report that said that in 15 years, earliest in 17 years, we would have a surplus deficit, we would have a fiscal deficit. But then the majority thought it's not a cause of concern. 52% believe we should use part of the reserve part of surplus for setting up a future fund, but 34% was against the idea and so on. So over the years, we can see from the budget that people were unhappy about the FS budget. They did not have trust in him, Mr. Andrew Leung. Now, this is the second budget of the FS in this term of the government. In terms of competitiveness, manpower resources, land supply, aging population, public finances, so on, various measures were proposed. It's also the first time that there was warning on the possible risk of fiscal structural deficit. Now, this is actually in line with the proposals of our BPA. That is, we should address our competitiveness issue. This is a long-term solution to our problems. Now, the policy address focused on poverty relief. The budget includes some measures that will support policy initiatives and mentioned in the policy address. And there is also more investment in infrastructure to enhance our competitiveness. We encourage people who have the capacity to work to rely on themselves so that we won't follow in the footsteps of other welfare states. Now, we want sustainable development of our economy. That means we must actively promote our development. Only then could we introduce more sources of revenue to the government and lessen the pressure on increasing taxes. Well, the broad direction proposed is right, but there are no details yet. I hope concrete action will be taken to help Hong Kong's economic development. I'm going to put forward some proposals for the government consideration. Now, it's easy to spend, it's hard to make money. The Working Group on Long-Term Fiscal Planning published a report recently. It's pointed out that if we maintain the same level of some services industry, that is, we have an annual growth of about 3%, then soonest in 7 years we will see structural deficit in Hong Kong. Basic Law Article 107 states that we must keep within our means in spending. We must ensure a balanced budget. We must avoid deficit. And our spending must be commensurate with the growth of GDP. The BPA has always asked the government to manage public finances prudently. And we also worried about increase in recurrent spending. We must not pass on fiscal deficit to our future generations. That's why BPA believes it's the right time for us to review whether we should keep public spending within 20% of GDP. This year, the FS has substantially reduced the number of sweeteners. Many, especially the middle class, have complained bitterly. They feel that they are once again ignored by the government. But, you know, sweetener is like poison. One day, sooner or later, our public coffers will be exhausted. At the end, it will be the middle class who would have to pick up the bill. If the government doesn't plan to increase the tax rate, that means we have to create new taxes. In our neighboring areas, Singapore and Namsha are considering reducing taxes. If Hong Kong create new taxes or increase taxes, we'll lose out on our competitiveness. And of course, it's possible that interest rate might go up and the property bubble would be bursted, and there will again be negative equities in Hong Kong. So we need to have stable and robust finances before we could actively invest in infrastructure and our future. And there must be measures to help SMEs to boost our competitiveness too. In 2012 to 2013, Singapore managed to maintain its GDP growth of 5.9%. Hong Kong only saw a growth of 2.8%. In terms of GDP growth rate, we left out to Singapore. We lost out to Singapore, but I think Hong Kong does better in terms of our innovation in industries and so on. So I think the government should do more to promote innovation. SMEs always been the backbone of economic development in Hong Kong. I welcome the acceptance of many proposals of the BPA, for example, extending the special loan guarantee scheme and so on. And also for micro, there is also additional measures to help small SMEs in terms of adopting cloud computing and so on. There are measures to believe cloud computing will help to reduce operating costs of SMEs. And SMEs could play a better role too in innovation and technology development. On product designs, R&D costs and so on, there must be tax deductions. Only then would the businesses care about investing more. On manpower training, I see the government is doing more on vocational training. $103 million will be spent to help retail industries to boost their productivity. VTC will help to train the people. But then $103 million would not be enough to substantially boost the quality of human resources. I think the government should do more for those aged 40 or below. There should be ways to help them reach level 3 of the qualifications framework. As Dr. Priscilla Leung pointed out, many blue-collar workers have good prospects. It's the same with vocational training. On financial services, we support the FS initiative to reduce profits tax for reinsurance, capture insurance companies. Now, for capture, but then there are already tax concessions for such insurance companies. How come for Section 39E of the Inland Revenue Ordinance, that's something we've been asking all along for concessions, that is, but government would not listen to us? I think the government should give us equal treatment. Now, we need to land to boost our competitiveness. in January last year, Singapore published a strategy on increasing land supply. They're going to increase land by about 10%, so that they will have an area of 766 square kilometers, and then their population may go up to 6.9 million. About 58% of the newly formed land would be for housing, communities purposes, or business purposes, and industrial land would account for about 70%. In Hong Kong, our overall land area is larger, but because there are various constraints, so we're not making good use of our land, as Singapore is, as Singapore does. Now, for Singapore, from planning department statistics, we know that 23% of built land, only 23% of our land is used, and only 2.17% is for industrial purposes. So we, I think the government should find out ways to boost land supply. There should also be appropriate reclamation and development caverns so that we could release more land for use. And there must also be shortening of the processing time for land use modification. Otherwise, Hong Kong may lag behind other countries in our development. Now, the 10-year housing production target is 470,000, 60% would be public sector housing. Now, the cost is about $1 million per unit. We're talking about some $200 billion in spending. And then there's need to build the third runway, and there are many other major infrastructure projects. So we see that the government is under heavy financial pressure. The BPA has suggested that the housing authority look into possible long-term fiscal financial arrangement, and also the government should adopt an enhanced supplementary labor scheme to address the labor shortage in the construction sector, and that will help to bring construction costs down. Now, of course, we must talk about the two harsh measures. After the introduction of the two harsh measures, transaction volume has dropped significantly. Still, property prices remain unaffordable. Now, the provisions in the harsh measures are not specific. There are a lot of loopholes there, so the government is not able to achieve its intended purpose of controlling property prices. Now, for businesses, they if they buy properties, they have to pay higher taxes, so they are deterred from coming to buy properties in Hong Kong. We don't know when the government will reverse these measures, so that adds to the uncertainty in the property market. Those with properties dare not sell, those without properties dare not buy, so the government must deal with that. One reason why property prices are high is because costs are high. The Chief Secretary for Administration pointed out this year, about 6-7 years ago, construction cost was just over $1,000 per square meter, but now it's as high as $4,000. The FS has also admitted in his budget that there is a shortage of manpower in many industries, and that stifles the development of industries. So the government has the duty to make sure we have enough manpower supply to meet the demands. So apart from strengthening training, the government should also speed up processing of labor importation for industries where there is a serious manpower shortage. Now, importing labor is not something to be feared. We could look at the labor importation policy in Singapore. Professor Chen Ka-keung also mentioned earlier, Singapore has seen faster economic growth than Hong Kong in recent years. They've also developing more land than Hong Kong by some 10 times. And also because Singapore is importing labor. Imported labor accounts for about a third of the workforce in Singapore. That's why building costs is much lower than that in Hong Kong, and that helps to speed up development. Now, we must let people see importing labor is not bad. So Singapore has also taxed employers who import workers that will help to promote development among local workers. It's also brought in extra income for the public coffers. And as the money is spent on retraining Singaporeans to take up high value-added jobs, and then non-skilled jobs will be taken up by imported workers that will help to promote social mobility. By 2018, our labor force will peak, and then the labor force will start to decline after that. So importation of labor must be discussed. I hope we will all be rational in discussing the matter and come up with a solution. With an aging population, the government has proposed extending the retirement age of civil servants, but that is not a long-term solution to the shortage of manpower. And healthcare services and elderly care services, there will be increasing demand for manpower, and public spending will also go up. The elderly have contributed much to Hong Kong, so the government must ensure they could live with dignity in their retirement life. We have to review the sharing of healthcare expenses in the long run. And so before the aging population becomes a problem, we have to find a way to ensure the sustainable operation, a provision of healthcare services. Now, there's globalization. Of course, Hong Kong may be subject to the impact of external economies. And so the government must, I think it's a good idea for the government to set up a future fund. It's well-intended. It helps us to save for rainy days. But then you put some of the surplus every year into the future fund, that may mean the government wouldn't be able to do as much in boosting our competitiveness, like lowering profits tax or supporting businesses. Investment, of course, involves risk. If you buy funds, doesn't mean you always make money. So the government must be very careful in weighing different factors. It must also conduct extensive consultation.
But this is a pragmatic and forward-looking budget. It points out that Hong Kong must come up with a sustainable fiscal planning. We should live within our means and enhance our competitive edge to face avoid a future structural deficit. We should increase land for commerce and business. We should encourage SMEs to upgrade themselves, and we should develop high value added industries, train up our manpower to meet the needs of future economic growth. Aging population is a problem faced by the many places. The government should not just import professionals. We still need low-skilled jobs and people who can carry out our infrastructure projects. Thank you. Mr. Michael Tin. Mr. President. Well, once both Hong Kong and Singapore were one of these four, well, were two of the tigers in Asia because of high growth, and inevitably people would compare Hong Kong with Singapore. Mr. Andrew Leung has just done that. We'll compare the economy, education, land, and other aspects. The more mature the economy, the lower the growth rate. In the past 10 years, Singapore broke this rule, and the growth rate was increasing. They developed their industries, they attract talents, they reclaim more land, developed their education system with bold measures. Our growth rate was only 2.7% on average, but Singapore's was 4.8%, which was 2 percentage points over ours. I hope the FS will bear these two the crucial numbers in mind. We can always learn from other people's good measures. We are not trying to suggest that we copy Singapore in a wholesome way, but we should learn from them and find out our own weaknesses so that we can improve, so that we will not be moving too slowly along the way. According to the government's latest report, we are going to face a structural deficit problem in 7 years' time. The more important thing is to increase our revenue instead of just looking at expenditure. Singapore is developing much more rapidly. It's because of the population policy and the reclamation that they are doing. There are 800,000 imported workers in Singapore, or 30% of the workforce. These people fill the vacancies that locals do not want to take up, and these jobs are instrumental
in their economic development. By importing labor, they can ensure steady growth. Although the economy is a mature economy, and still they have a sustained growth. In Hong Kong, we only 3,000 imported workers, or 1% of our workforce. Every time when you want to talk about importation of labor, most properties will be most alarmed. It seems that it is a taboo subject, and no one should talk about that. For in industries, the construction industry, the elderly services sector, they face an acute and chronic and acute shortage of labor. No one seems to care about their situation. But in 2018, our labor workforce will peak, and then it will decline. If we don't do things to supplement our workforce, then when is the time to do it? And Singapore is also faster than us in creating land. According to the Secretary for Development, the reclaimed land in Singapore account for 20% of their urban area. In Hong Kong, it's 7%. I've said this time and again, to maintain a sustainable supply in the long term, we must rely on reclamation. In the North, we know what happened to the Northeast NT project, and the new towns, only 60,000 people were accommodated over a period of 20 years. Can we go down the same route in the future? I've asked the government whether they have got a timetable for reclamation, and there was no response. A few years ago, I asked this question of the FSTB. Did they acknowledge that we face a shortage of manpower and land, and that's the reason why we lag behind Singapore? The secretary admitted that this is the case. Land and manpower are the constraints faced by Hong Kong, but we do not have to copy what Singapore has been doing. But this is puzzling to me. On the one hand, you have identified your weaknesses and shortcomings, and on the other, you are saying that we don't need to do anything about them. And also you talk about a possible structural deficit in 15 years' time when our land views are all used up. So what can we do? Are we just sit here with folded arms and wait for the doom? Singapore has been developing not just because it has been quick in promoting the right population policy. Singapore attaches importance to education. She understands that education is not an expenditure, it's an investment. If you want to invest, you can reap more profits in the future. Mr. President, here I would like to ask money, for some money from the FS for our students and also for our elders. Education accounts for a certain percentage of our public expenditure. It reflects our commitment. From 2012, for the 5 years, education accounts for 20% of our expenditure. Singaporean percentage was 38%. So we are not doing sufficiently in this regard. We can learn from Singapore that we should invest more in education. The Education Bureau has been reluctant to increase the number of subsidized first-year university places. Well, I've been talking about this in the past, and I will be talking about this in the future. Since 1989, we set our goal of providing 14,500 first-year surrender places in universities. It's now only 500 more. The provision is inappropriate. The Singapore ratio is 27% for the relevant age group. it would like to raise the percentage to 35%, and then to 40% for the relevant age group. Well, I'm not asking you to do the same thing and raise the percentage progressively. I'm just asking you to raise the percentage to what Singapore is having now, is 27%. I imagine that our circumstances are different from Singapore's circumstances. It's the responsibility of the government. There's no avoiding of this. If you don't have, unless you don't have money, how can you say that you should provide a different level of subsidized university places? In 16,000 students in 2012-13, 2013-14 are eligible, but they have got no play offers. These students have good grades, and they have to pay for their own associated degree education. So what the government has done for them, number of places will increase by 1,000 in phases, and there will be 5,000 more in 2018-2019. Now, one examination determines the student's fate. And after they have done quite well, but there's no place for them, they have to be enrolled on associate degree programs. And after completing the programs, they may not progress further. So employment and education are difficult for associate degree holders. Employers don't give a lot of recognition. And I asked this question of the secretary. The secretary asked them to be enrolled on self-financing programs. If we are to raise the percentage from 19% to 20%, which is the Singapore's percentage, the government would need to provide an additional 5,600 places. According to the government, the unit cost per place is about $200,000, and a course will last for 4 years. For 5,600 places, the annual expenditure would increase by $4.4 billion per year. We have an expenditure of $770 billion in education. It's a 3.8% of our GDP. 77 billion. So if you spend another $4.4 billion, it would increase the percentage of GDP to 4%, from 3.8% of GDP to 4%, an increase of 0.2 percentage point. And in Singapore, the education accounts for 4.1% of the GDP, and by 2020, they would increase the percentage of enrollment to the 40% from the current 27%. Singapore understands the importance of education. They will never cut back on the spending on education. I'm not asking for the enrollment rate to 50 or 60% that we can see in European countries. So why is it that the government is still trying not to spend more on education? Mr. Financial Secretary, expenditure on education is not an expenditure. You spend more on education as a percentage on the GDP. You are going to gained a return in terms of a higher percentage of GDP growth. Apart from education, I'm also concerned about dental health, dental care for the elderly. Toothache is worse than a major disease. There are only a few outpatient dental clinics for elderly. But in 2012, only 100,000 sections were provided. So 95% of our elderly population cannot have access to public dental service. The government only takes care of the dental health of 5% of our elderly people. Is it reasonable? For the remaining 95%, if they can afford it, they go to a private dental clinic. What about those belonging to the grassroots? Well, they will have to tolerate and suffer. Only in 2013, 80% of them do not have any dental service. In order to get at this, how far can these elderly people go? They would start to queue up from 2 o'clock just to get at this for dental service.
I hope the administration will extend dental care for the elderly and cover it with public expenditure. Let me give you the sums. Serving 50,000 people, about just a few percentage. There are about 1 million elderly. If dental care is provided, that will be an additional $500 million. The healthcare expenses per year is $50 billion. So $500 million is just 1%. So that's a small sum. The administration has a duty. The administration should economize on this. Helping the elderly, caring for the elderly is a traditional value. Whether it's education for the young people and dental care for the elderly, the administration has not done enough. We should learn from the experience of the countries. We learn and we know our inadequacies, and when we know our inadequacies, we can strengthen ourselves. Instead of dodging the issue and try to ignore the illness, the administration should provide the medicine and cure the illness. With this, thank you, Mr. President. Ms. Ellis Mack. Before I go into my speech proper, I refer to the examples mentioned by members with regard to Singapore. They say that Hong Kong should take a lead from Singapore experience and import labor. Now, if you want to learn from Singapore to solve its labor shortage, and in Singapore, in order to deal with traffic congestion, they limit the number of cars, they impose heavy license fees, heavy taxes on only a car, and they cannot just own their cars for life. Should we learn that from Singapore? For the health of young people, they ban the sale of chewing gums, they ban one kind of food or another. If we are to learn from Singapore, we also need to know the situation of Hong Kong. Hong Kong is different from Singapore. In Hong Kong, there are many low-skill middle-aged people who are jobless. We have fresh graduates. In particular, those in their teens are not able to get jobs. Many of them are unemployed. And we have half a million women who have yet to join our labor force. If we are not able to solve the employment problems of these groups of Hong Kong people, we shouldn't say we should learn from Singapore. Otherwise, you should learn not just in run expect. If you get a certain brand of toothpaste that is 100% more expensive than Hong Kong, and with regard to importation of labor, Singaporeans are really are unhappy with that policy. Let me now go back to the budget. I go to consult the people, and I had many rallies among the residents, and I set up stalls to collect views. We asked people what do people think about the budget. The first response is there is no more sweeties, less sweeteners, no tariff, electricity tariff subsidy, and only 1 month of wind waiver for the PRH tenants. These responses, I believe, are expected by the FS. But when I hear their response, I put another question to them. In the 70s, 80s, 90s, or rather 60s, 70s, and 90s, they had to work two jobs. They lived in partition flats. They had to share toilets and bathrooms with other people. Did you ask the government to pay rent for you? Did you ask the government to pay electricity tariff for you? We were suffering at that time, and yet we didn't ask anything from the government then. Why? We now ask the government to do this and do that. In those days, when Hong Kong was the poorest, Hong Kong people had two jobs or three jobs, and they had a future. They could see a bright future. But in Hong Kong, however hard you try, you see no bright future. The GDP is adding, is increasing. We see economic growth, but we are not able to share the fruit of success. Just some of the people have benefited from the economic growth, and a lot of people are still suffering despite economic growth. The government has a lot of money in its pockets. If it is not going to spend the money, why can't he give out the money to us? When we ask you to hand out the sweeteners, you have to consider why people of Hong Kong are still suffering, why they ask for handing out of sweeteners. In fact, we put strong emphasis on self-reliance. When we were in primary schools, we were told that the most precious treasure of Hong Kong, apart from the Victoria Harbour, which was a natural harbour, was manpower. And why? We need to rely on the government for the sweeteners. In the budget, in the preamble, in the review, in the forecast, then the FS came to the paragraphs on enhancing competitiveness. The low-income earners and the middle class are of the view that they are no longer valuable. We are not treasured, and other places also want Hong Kong people to work for them. It seems that Hong Kong people are no longer valuable. We've lost our edge. The FS, in his report, said that all along we have the four traditional pillar industries to support our economy. He then spoke on how such industries are to be developed, but I'm disappointed that among the four pillar industries, the largest coverage is on speculation, financial services, i.e. financial services. Hong Kong is an international financial center. The development of our financial services sector contributes to our economy. But we also want job opportunities for the grassroots, and we also want people to have upward mobility. When they work hard, they can have a raise in salaries, they will get promotion. People don't have a chance to get three jobs. It's really lucky if you can get a job, not to say three jobs. Let's look at the logistics industry as an example. I said that before. In the budget, the FS said that our logistics industry suffered challenges from our neighbors. The FS therefore proposed to develop logistic land use in the airport island and 30 hectares of land in Tsing Yi, and then brown land in Hong Kong, and we made good use of brown land to build brownfield sites to develop the support logistic industry. When we had the special finance committee meeting, we discussed the development of brownfield sites. Now, the word or the phrase appeared in the budget, but the planning department colleagues said that they didn't have a definition for brownfield sites. And they didn't have information on the size of brownfield sites in their hands. But this FS said that he would make use of brownfield sites to develop logistic industry. Is it just an empty term? As for the quote-unquote brownfield sites, they are used for certain logistic process because brownfield sites are cheap, though they are remote in the new territories. Now, if you want to make it easy to manage, you have multi-story buildings for container storage and for goods, for container trucks parking. Are they suitable for the logistic industry? Look at the several sites in Kwai-ching for logistics. After the tendering exercise, the sites were taken up by large consortia, and they charge high rents on the logistic industry, and our logistic industry is facing the same problem. They don't have suitable sites for operation. Many who have been working in doing business in the logistic industry have decided to fold up because they've lost their hope. Those who still want to operate are moving further away. They're moving farther away. Instead of working in Kwai-ching, they go to the brownfield sites, though the brownfield sites are denied by the planning department. SMEs go to remote sites to operate, and now you are going to resume their land. So is there any policy to assist the logistic industry, or you just allow themselves to die out? Now, that is the Logistic Development Council, and the council will draw up grand plans, but the council only has three meetings in a year. Let us look at what reports they have. The latest report was done in 2009. What are the opportunities and challenges of our logistic industry in Hong Kong? What update information do we have? What update information do they have for the administration? We don't blame the council members because they are just volunteers for the government in terms of giving advice to the government. The most important thing is whether the government has any long-term logistic industry policy. Among the four pillar industries, I only mentioned the logistic industry. If you look at our back garden, the Kwai-ching container terminal, Kwai-chung container terminal, it creates a lot of jobs, say document processing, transportation, shipping, warehousing, accounting, a lot of jobs are created by the logistic industry. They are jobs for low-skill middle-aged workers and also for graduates, and that can enable Hong Kong people to have a bright future. And that can help us to enhance our competitiveness so that our manpower is still of value. Let me now turn to healthcare. Since the population is aging, healthcare is the greatest challenge. The elderly have poor health because they worked very hard when they were young. They had hidden injuries when they during their working life. Healthcare cost is the issue. Expenditure on the elderly aged 65 or above should be a big sum. But when I put my question to the administration on healthcare costs for those above age 65, the administration said that they didn't have the number. If they don't have the number, the so-called working group, which looked into the increase in healthcare costs, without this number, what are they doing? How do they know what the future problem is? As for the healthcare voucher for the elderly, the amount or the face value will be increased by 100%. The administration claims that that is in response to our demand. The FTU has been asking the administration to provide dental care to the elderly. The administration said we can't have a dental care voucher. The elderly has other needs, so the health care voucher is increased to $1,000. But the standard is the elderly should have 20 healthy teeth. In 2011, in the dental care survey, we have yet to reach this standard. What does it mean? Dental care shouldn't start with the age of 70. We should do it much earlier. And elderly should be reminded, the elderly should be reminded that they should care for their dental health. The dental health care voucher should be implemented as soon as possible, and it should cover those age 60 or above.
There's some health insurance scheme. We're told that it might come out this year. Well, anyway, on health insurance, I have expectation, but I hope I won't be let down. Now, how much support would there be from the sector and the community? We wouldn't know. In any case, in the coming, in the next budget, the FS must deliver on your pledge. There must be a tax deduction for medical insurance so as to benefit the middle class. On dental care, the Kwai-ching District Council is going to use some of our provisions to sub-fund dental care services for elderly people so that elderly people could afford to take care of their teeth. But I understand some members of pledge today would engage in filibustering. May I appeal to these members? If you don't like the budget, oppose it, vote against it, please do not engage in filibustering, because otherwise there are people's livelihoods issues which will be delayed. You know, elderly people couldn't wait that long for their teeth to be taken care of. The council, district council has a bit of money to help them, not much, but it's better than nothing. So please do not delay the funding provision so that we could take good care of the teeth of our old people. Thank you. Mr. Leung Yiu-chung. This is the seventh budget of the financial secretary. Unfortunately, this budget, like the previous ones, has nothing new. There's no pleasant surprises, as disappointing. Now, the government has long given out winds that it would reduce the number of sweeteners, and is also quoted from a report of the Working Group on Long-Term Fiscal Planning to address our long-term issues in relation to aging population. So all that needs to be said has been said before. What's the point of this budget? That's why this budget has got the worst review so far. It's a new low since 2003. The average score is only 49.8. And since the financial secretary delivered his budget, his first budget in 2008, this is the budget with the lowest score. Is it to be expected, if you ask me? The budget, of course, is to help CY Leung to salvage his dropping popularity. So there are financial provisions, funding provisions for the initiatives it's announced in relation to relieving poverty. But what is we are not happy about is that in the budget, FS is trying to adopt scaremongering. That is, if there is an income growth of 4.5% and spending growth of 5.3%, then in 15 years we have structural deficit. If the average annual income growth is 7%, then the structural deficit will be there in 7 years. That's why there's need to set up a future fund so we could cater for rainy days. It's because of this principle. So in terms of healthcare, education, or support for persons with disabilities, there will be constraints. We cannot provide more support to these groups. In that case, how can you expect people to support your budget? the financial secretary and the working group on long-term fiscal planning gave their comments, and yes, it's worrying. But as a financial secretary, how can we make long-term fiscal planning based on such simplistic linear growth assumptions? How can we not have regard to the dynamics in development? How can we make static projections like this? So does it mean that you are not that capable, you're not taking seriously your responsibility, and are you trying to insult our intelligence? Over a decade ago, the government said that Hong Kong would face a structural deficit, and every year the deficit would be as high as $60 billion and we would soon exhaust our reserve. In 2005, it was also pointed out that because we had a narrow tax base and we relied too heavily on property-related income, it's not healthy, so there was a suggestion to widen the tax base and there was a suggestion to introduce the sales tax. But let's look at the actual situation in the past decade. In the past decade, the economic development, the government revenue and spending did not evolve in such a way that is a linear development as projected, as assumed by the government. But rather, there were highs, ups and downs, there were highs and lows. It's not a linear development, definitely. That's why people have come to conclude that the projection made by the FS was crude. He's not serious about addressing the widening wealth gap problem. And so we see the rich getting richer, the poor getting poorer. So we should strongly condemn the financial secretary and the working group on long-term fiscal planning. I think we can look at some examples. In 2004 and 2004 to 2005, government spend revenue was $263.6 billion, spending $242.2 billion. By 2005 to 2006, revenue was $247 billion, spending was $233.1 billion. So a drop of 6% in terms of revenue, but also a drop of 3% in spending. From 2005 to 2007. Income actually went up by 17%. Spending was less by 1.5%. It was just a short span of 2 years, and we saw such major change. So in 10, 15 years, would there be even far more major changes? Maybe you would say, I've only looked at the situation for a year or two, it's not representative. So arbitrarily, I've looked at figures for 2010 to 2011 and 2011 to 2012. I tried to compare the 2 years. Now, revenue has actually gone up by 16%, but of course, spending has also gone up by 20% during those 2 years. Now, it's not the point about the changes in spending and income, but rather I just want to prove that the projections of the FS do not hold water. It's not scientific. It's a distorted argument. So people have to wonder why they are making such projections. What are they aiming at? Of course, we do have to to consider whether there will be a deficit in Hong Kong, and we do have to plan for the future, but do we just rely on such crude projections and then say for the rainy days indiscriminately? Are we then therefore to overlook some deep-seated problems in the community, and then should we just suppress spending without good reasons? It's true, an aging population is to be expected, but can we achieve nominal GDP growth of 4.4%? We don't know. There may also be decline in income of the people, so the government may not be able to maintain a growth of 4.5% per annum. But then As I said, the community evolves in a dynamic manner. There are many factors affecting changes. You know, it's but these factors are external and internal. It also depends on government's policies too. And all these elements are subject to change. That's why we must not be too pessimistic. At the same time, we can't be too optimistic. But the FS has never mentioned a point, our reserve. Maybe we're fortunate, Mr. President. In the past few years, there's been much growth in the wealth of the government and the people. So in future, even if the income drops and there is deficit, we could still make use of our reserve to address the financial pressure brought about by an aging population. The reserve and exchange fund together have $1,400 billion. If we invest wisely, then we could get any return of 5%. So every year we will have an additional income of $70 billion. And that would help to address the financial pressure brought about by an aging population, so we could afford to deal with the issue. Now, even if the government is to face structural deficit in future, we shouldn't just stress that we should do something about the speed of growth in public spending, but rather we should review critically whether our spending items are appropriate. And as we spend, are we able to boost the competitiveness of Hong Kong? That's what we should look at. The government should also review whether the current taxation regime is outdated so that changes could be made in a timely manner. On various occasions, government officials kept saying that we have a narrow base for income sources. We rely heavily on high income earners and a few conglomerates. It's true, that's a point. Say for 2010 to 11 and 2011 to 12, those who pay salary tax 200,000, the top taxpayers 200,000 pay for more than half of the salary tax, and 10% of companies pay for more than 7% of the profits tax. So that we can see there is a small number of people or companies shouldering the bulk of the tax burden. But the government has never analyzed why that's the case. It's because the government doesn't want to face up to the problem. It won't tell us why there are so few people paying so much tax. They would only tell us that we have a narrow tax base. Now, we would all like to pay so much tax if we could. It's just that for the majority of businesses and individuals, they earn relatively less. That's why they are not taxed so much, because they don't have so much income. That shows that there is an even distribution of wealth in this community, and wealth is concentrated in the hands of a few. If more people could see the higher to make higher income, they don't need to rely on government support. They could actually bring more revenue to the government. That's why we shouldn't just talk about widening the tax base. Rather, we have to find out ways to rectify this unreasonable and uneven distribution of wealth. Taxes are supposed to distribute wealth equally and reasonably. So that's an important tool to avoid wealth being concentrated in a few people. But the FS is not doing more in that respect, but rather he's turned things the other way around. For conglomerates or tycoons, they are able to enjoy tax rate exemption and tax rebate. So are you going the wrong way? Profits tax is to allow the redistribution of economic benefits. Of course, we see small and medium sized businesses face heavy financial pressure, it's not fair to increase tax on them. But then the government doesn't have regard to how much money a company pays. All companies pay the same amount, same percentage of profits tax. So those who are rich become richer as a result. Is it fair? Now we see the inadequacies remain, but then for salaries tax as a progressive tax system, that is those who earn more pay more taxes. How come for those who make more profits in their businesses don't pay more tax? There are other tax issues too, like what about vacant property tax, capital gains tax, and other taxes that may narrow the wealth gap. You know, all these taxes could be considered. Unfortunately, our government refuses to do that all along. It dares not to target the conglomerates. And it doesn't care about the needs of grassroots. Actually, many of our colleagues have already mentioned that.
For example, retirement protection, child care, and as many colleagues have said, dental services for the elderly, treatment for the elderly, and so on. And yet the administration has done nothing about those. So this budget gives us an impression that once again, the administration is favoring those who have to enjoy the fruits of our success, and it is widening the gap between the rich and the poor. So how can we accept and support this? So I'll be voting against it. Thank you. Mr. Jeffrey Lam. President, this year's budget, in terms of spending on welfare, the recurrent expenditure has increased, and for one-off handouts, we have seen a reduction in that. Many people are of the view that for helping measures or relief measures for the middle class, that should increase. And the business sector is also of the view that the relief measures for the SMWs or SMEs have not gone far enough. And we also have the working group on long-term fiscal planning. And the report points out that if government spending continues to exceed government revenue, then as short as 7 years, we're going to have structural deficit. And in recent years, many people have said that our reserve is flooded with money and we have got a huge surplus, and many people would still like the administration to give out or to give more handouts, and it never dawns on them that we could have a deficit. In fact, if you look at the past few years, government spending has been rising. At the same time, we are faced with an aging population. So in the future, spending on taking care of the elderly and welfare for the poor will go up. And therefore, we have to deal with this public finance very seriously, because I'm sure nobody would like to face this issue of a budget deficit. In fact, if you look at European countries, many of them used to have their glorious days, like Greeks. But then, today, it has to rely on debt. And do we want to experience that? Mr. President, I agree with what the FS said. We have to adhere to this prudent financial management principles that is under Article 107 of the Basic Law. We have to live within our means and make sure that our expenditure will be commensurate with our economic growth. That is to avoid having a structural deficit. And what the administration should be doing is to open up more sources of revenue, including promoting the development of industries and improving Hong Kong's business environment, attracting more overseas investors to come to Hong Kong and providing greater support for our SMEs. What's most important is we should make the economic pie bigger, so that both in terms of entering and going out of Hong Kong will be easier, and there would also be more upward mobility for the younger people. And if we have good development and if there are good opportunities, then we don't have to feel besieged by the city. with spending going up all the time and with an aging population, that would also bring about a lot of financial pressure. I don't think there is one single panacea that can solve all problems. And therefore, the administration must adopt a multi-pronged approach before we can gradually resolve some of the problems that we are facing. In the budget, the financial secretary took the lead to say that with over $10 billion surplus, the FS took the lead to halve the handouts, for example, for our rates rebate and also our electricity tariff rebate. They were both halved. So I think he was trying to reverse the thinking that we're going to have handouts every time. So it's like the lyric which says that we should not just believe in opportunity, not fate, and that's the mindset of Hong Kong people. But then many people have been working very hard and they have been contributing to our community. They've been paying tax year after year. They've never thought about relying on government welfare. But then with inflation and increase in commodity prices, even the middle class are experiencing difficulties and their expenditure has been going up, and therefore the administration should be more understanding about the plight of the middle class and try to help them a bit more. I agree that the administration should help those who are in need, but then at the same time, we also hope that the administration would also understand the difficulty and hardship of the middle class and how they feel. The middle class is a pillar of our society. They have been contributing to our community and they have been spending and spending, and they very rarely would make noises. But then in recent years, we have heard them coming forward, speaking out more loudly. But then it doesn't mean that they have done so out of no reason. Well, they've been paying taxes, but then the taxes have not been spent on them. That's why they have had some grievances. The administration should therefore look at why they have aired those grievances. The administration should not ignore how they feel. The administration should instead consider some of their suggestions, for example, voluntary healthcare insurance, and also the contribution should enjoy tax allowance and so on. And the administration should also create wealth. And both myself and the General Chamber of Commerce have been suggesting that the administration should invest more heavily in areas where there would be high value-added development. We are pleased to see that they have accepted some of our suggestions, for example, to help the SMEs to enhance their IT capability, and also there would also be more cloud computing, and the SMEs would also be given more support, and also for the export sector, more subsidy would be given to them, and tertiary institutions' R&D capability would also be enhanced. These would also help to enhance Hong Kong's overall competitiveness. But then, Mr. President, I think that in terms of support for the business sector, as spelled out in the budget, is still far from adequate, because cash flow is very much the lifeline for the SMEs, and we've been suggesting that we should lower the profit tax rate to 15%. We should also implement the two-tier profit tax system so that for the first $2 million taxable income, that should be reduced to 15%, but then the budget is totally silent on that. We believe that this will not affect Hong Kong's simple tax system. In fact, that would also help attract more overseas investors to come to Hong Kong. In fact, by cutting tax, it doesn't mean that our revenue will come down. In fact, in the past, if you look at our wine duty, estate duty, well, in the end, Hong Kong's revenue has gone up as a result of the scrapping of those taxes. So it doesn't necessarily mean that by cutting certain taxes, our revenue will also correspondingly come down. Well, Mr. President, since the FS said that he would like to create more opportunities so that people would be able to move up the social ladder, then the administration must improve the business environment so that more people will start their business and invest in Hong Kong, so that there will be more opportunities for the public to move up the social ladder and the spirit can also be further promoted. The FS also said that we could use the land funds surplus so that we can set up this future fund so that where there is a deficit, the administration will still be able to launch certain infrastructure projects in order to promote the development of our economy. So do we have to wait till it's a critical moment, or when our revenue is not able to meet our expenses? So should we have a longer term arrangement so that we will know exactly when we will be doing what, instead of waiting till the very last minute before we would do that? So what's meant by the critical moment? I believe that if such a fund is to meet future infrastructure expenditure, then the SAR government will also have to note that in the construction sector, we are seriously short of staff and construction costs has been going up. And if that should continue, then escalating construction costs will multiply in 10 years. So even the future fund might not be able to cope. So will the fund be able to do what the administration wants it to do? So I hope that the FS and the relevant departments will look into this as to how the fund should be used and how it's going to be operated. I also hope that we'll be able to get a better return from the fund so that the fund can be used on constructing or building the future of Hong Kong. Mr. President, this year's budget uses competition or competitiveness as its theme, but then we are short of talents. That's why it has affected our competitiveness. Even though the administration has been working very hard to nurture more talents, it will take time for us to build up those pool of talents. But then in some sectors, for example, the construction sector and so on, because of the serious shortage of manpower, it has also affected our long-term development. If you look at our neighbors and also their governments, they have been very bold in considering importing labor, and they've also come up with relevant policies. But then our government has been very slow in responding to that. What is it afraid of? It is afraid of criticism. Is it concerned that our cost is not high enough? If that is the case, then our economy will suffer. In particular, if we were to implement a large number of infrastructure projects, and if the administration still does not resolve this problem early, then in the end, those who will suffer will be the Hong Kong public. And even if land cost comes down, but then if construction costs escalate, then property prices will not come down. So how can we resolve this problem? How can we help our middle class and the younger generation to buy flats and own their own homes? That's why we urge the administration to look into the relevant sectors so that we can import labor for the construction sector. And of course, the prerequisite is that local workers must not be adversely affected. To resolve this problem of a shortage of talents in Hong Kong, I think an effective way is to change the existing policy so that more young people can be attracted to come to Hong Kong, and certain professional requirements can also be relaxed. For example, overseas doctors can be allowed to practice in Hong Kong. I think we have talked about that for a long time. Medical doctors, well, it's not about where they have been trained and whether or not they should be allowed to practice, or whether or not they will result in patients being killed. In fact, some Hong Kong residents actually go overseas to seek treatment. So why can't we attract these quality doctors to come and practice in Hong Kong? Is there some problem with our system? And of course, other than doctors, there are other professions which are also experiencing similar problems. So we should be more open-minded in considering this. We can do a good job in that area. Well, many people who are advocating nativism, and they're also against allowing professionals to come to Hong Kong. In the end, we will be paying a heavy price for that if we shut our doors. Well, Hong Kong is an international financial center. If we allow that sort of thoughts to take root, then that would only affect our status. In fact, when we scrutinize the budget, once again, some members are going to filibuster, and they've actually introduced some 2,000 amendments, and their practice has disappointed the public. I hope that, Mr. President, you will appropriately deal with that without having us to spend dozens of days here. And of course, under your smart leadership and wise leadership, I'm sure you'll be able to deal with our budget and appropriation bill so that it can be passed as soon as possible and the public will be able to have money to spend. Well, last year, they spent 15 days on the filibustering and some $30 million was spent on this. And this year, they said that they might extend our budget debate until May or even June. And the spending would involve different departments, healthcare, education, and the grassroots, and so on. And if the appropriation bill is delayed, then both the government and the grassroots will suffer. They will be short of cash, and they will be short of money, and they might also be short of food. And many meetings of this council can also not proceed. Well, last year, I also submitted a bill or a motion, but then I was not able to discuss that because of the filibustering. And many bills committees have also got to stop their work. And many livelihood issues could not be debated or discussed. So for those who champion for people's livelihood, they will have to give it a second thought. They will really have to think about people's livelihood, and also they will also have to understand how the public feel about this. I also hope that you can be resolute in dealing with what I just said. I hope that there will not be a repeat of history, and I believe that under your wise leadership, well, in dealing with debate in this council, we should not allow people who are not constructive or who are making repetitive remarks to waste our time affecting government departments' operation and the grassroots livelihood, and also the operation of this council, and also to damage or undermine the dignity of this council.
Mr. Leung Chi-chang, President, although housing is among the top priorities in each year's policy address, this is not so in the budget. There is rates relief in the policy address. Other than that, there are no surprises in housing and also no shock to speculators. Although the budget has not started any discussion of our housing policy, that doesn't mean that the public are pleased with the government's housing policy. Just last month, the DAB did an opinion poll on the level of satisfactory on the government's policy, housing policy. The respondents were still not happy with the government's housing policy, and the extent of dissatisfaction aggravated last year. Or in the past year, rentals were high. Those in the middle class found it difficult to buy flats, and the waiting list for PRH is also increasing, and there is no breakthrough in the supply of PRH, and there is still imbalance, serious imbalance of supply and demand. And of course, people who are waiting for PRH have to pay very high rent, and they have a lot of grievances. Of course, the budget is not a policy address, still it can mention new measures in housing to show the government's commitment in increasing housing supply. The second day after the last year's budget delivery, the application list was abolished to show that the government would take the lead in deciding land supply for housing. A year has elapsed, but we have not seen any cooperation on the part of private developers and the MTLC. So was not taken up yet, and then Tin Shui Wai also suffered two abortive tendering. According to statistics, in 2012-13, the number of flats under construction and also the expected production or completion number failed to reach the target of 18,800 as proposed in the long-term housing strategy. In the first few years of the LTHS, we're quite sure that the targets cannot be met. So in the coming 10 years, I don't think we can achieve the target of 180,000 flats in 10 years' time. So even before the strategy has started, it is doomed to fail. I hope the government can take one more step. Be flexible. If it is expected that housing supply from the private sector would fall below expectation that the government should provide more sites or turn sites for private housing to HOS or other subsidized housing developments. Take a Tin Wing station of Tin Shou as an example. The site is about 2 hectares in area. It can provide for 4 blocks and 1,500 units. However, it failed in 2 tendering exercises. If the government can discuss with the MTRC to turn it to an HOS development, then come 2018, we'll be able to have 1,500 HOS flats available. Of course, that involves financial arrangements. And I hope that the FS can give your full support to this proposal. Although we have shelved the Hong Kong Property for Hong Kong People measure, it's not something in the budget. It has recently stolen the limelight. Yes, it is one of the major policies of the CE, and he said that he would consider introducing the Hong Kong Property for Hong Kong People policy. If conditions are ripe, then in the land sale conditions, it can be specified that flats completed can only be sold to Hong Kong permanent residents and non-permanent residents. So as to provide more housing for Hong Kong people. Yes, I understand that the policy will restrict non-Hong Kong people from buying properties in Hong Kong. And the idea is to help the sandwich class to become flat owners. When property prices are so high, well, this policy will block non-Hong Kong people from buying flats, but it is not useful in helping Hong Kong permanent residents to own their flats. So whether the policy stays or not is not a big deal. What is the alternative to this policy in order to achieve the target? The housing society has got 10 years of experience in helping the sandwich class to become flat owners. It built 10 sandwich class development projects. Since the administration has decided to shelve this policy, it should consider relaunching the sandwich class or similar housing program so that we can more proactively help people whose earnings are over the HOS threshold to become flat owners. As regards to welfare, social welfare expenditure has increased to $56.9 billion, an unprecedented rise, accounting for 18.5% of the government's recurring expenditure. Just after education, spending for elderly services has risen to 5.4% or $5.4 billion or a rise of 40%. This can show the government's commitment to help the underprivileged, and you can have my support for that. But for elders who have just retired, as they have turned 60 years old, they say to me that while the government has done a lot to help the elders, such as the $2 traffic fare concession, free vaccination, and also increasing the elderly health voucher scheme to $2,000, well, they're only able to enjoy it when they have reached 65 years old. We have 140,000 elders aged between 60 and 64. And they are not eligible for such welfare. According to the... So they have to put up with high prices before they can enjoy such concessions. And it's ironical that those who have retired are not eligible to enjoy such benefits. Some elders may want to join the workforce after they have retired, but according to the Census and Statistics Department, we have 180,000 retired elders who are not old enough to enjoy such social benefits are still unemployed. they have to spend a lot on daily expenses, and yet they cannot enjoy the social benefits for elderly persons. And they've said to me that they have no income, they have lots of expenses, so they have to cut corners. And this financial burden has make it impossible for them to enjoy their retirement. Most government departments and most organizations in the public and private sector have set the retirement age at 60 years old. And only last week, the government issued a consultation document planning to extend the retirement age of civil servants to 65 years old. In future, all newly recruited civil servants will retire at 65 years old, and for the disciplined services, the retirement age will be extended to 57 years old. But from the proposal to implementation, it takes at least 1 year. Besides, the scope of application will be confined to newly recruited civil servants. Incumbent civil servants can still decide when to retire depending on their own aspiration and the needs of the departments they serve. And therefore, there will be a lot, still there will be a lot of elders aged between 60 to 64 who are not eligible for the benefits I just mentioned. And therefore, the government should review its various social welfare benefits for the elderly. In particular, in areas of transport and healthcare, well, the eligibility age should be lowered to 60 years old. As social welfare improves, or I mean healthcare improves, many elders are still very able after they've retired at 60 years old, such as Mr. Chow Chung Kong, the CEO of MTR. He was only 61 when he retired from his post. Now he's 64 years old, he's still the chairman of SFC and also chairman of the Hong Kong Chamber of General Chamber of Commerce and also a member of the Executive Council. He is still fit and able. We have over 20 council members here, over 60 years old. That is one-third of the council, but all of them are still very fit and smart. And it is common for the private sector to employ those who are over 60 years old. The employers and employees can have their own form of employment. For instance, it can be by means of a contract or part-time model. According to the census in 2011, in the age group 60 to 64 years old, 443,000 persons were still working in the form of self-employed employees. This is only 40,000 less than those who are retired. In fact, elders who continue to work after retirement will enjoy better health, both mentally and physically. So the government should formulate policies to help enterprises to employ elders after retirement. For instance, for by providing allowances or tax concessions to public and private enterprises that employ this group of elders so that they can continue to contribute to society and hand down their valuable experience to the next generation. Thank you. Mr. Wong Ting-kwong. Thank you, President. Thank you, President. I think this year's budget is a pragmatic one. On the one hand, it has addressed livelihood aspirations and has also taken care of our financial capability. There are more than 100 measures announced in the policy address. And it has also filled the gap in terms of support for SMEs. I think SMEs should be assured by this budget. As said by the financial sector, over 90% of our enterprises are SMEs, employing at least half of our workforce, involving 1.3 million jobs. They are really the pillars of our economy. However, rents are high in Hong Kong, and everything is expensive, and operating costs have risen, and the external environment is rather volatile, and the U.S. may withdraw from the market quite soon, and it's not certain what volatilities we face in the future. Large enterprises also monopolize the market, and SMEs are finding it difficult to survive. SMEs need capital chain. It's just like our blood. When we have good circulation, we can survive. But usually, SMEs are not very famous. They don't have a lot of assets. It's difficult for them to take out borrowings from banks. Even if they can, they have to pay high interest. So this SME financing guarantee scheme is a lifeblood boil for the SMEs. The government offers guarantee to banks so that they can comfortably provide loans for SMEs. 2 years ago, the government enhanced the measures. So the guarantee was increased from 70% to 80% to further encourage banks to provide loans to SMEs. That was a good policy.
As at the end of February, there has been over 9,300 applications. This is a good measure, but still there is room for improvement. Currently, there is a low interest rate. And so the cost for capital for bank is really low. And on top of that, there is guarantee from the government. Still, the bank charges a high interest. Some can be 4.77%. Some of them can be as high as 10%. A lot of enterprises told us that, yes, the government has put into a lot of thought into this policy, but there are some obstacles, including high threshold, complicated procedures and formalities, and the application process is rather long. So it you will have to wait a long time before you get some help. And if they would like to offer financing guarantee, then they should give it the whole nine yards. Of course, I understand that the government will not interfere in the banking sector and will not interfere in the interest rate imposed, but they can take into account the cost by the banks and to better understand the difficulties faced by SMEs, that will be even better. The administration should streamline the application procedure and shorten the waiting time. And take into account changes of the market and regularize these special measures to ensure that SMEs who are in need will get the help they require. Apart from worrying about financing difficulties, SMEs, of course, are worried about debt, bad debts, especially export-import companies. If a customer business closes down, or maybe there are some force of nature, some problems, and then as a result, their products are destroyed, then they will not be able to expect payment. There is some small policy protection scheme offering SMEs waivers of premium or a discount when they take out insurance. And then this way, it will give them peace of mind. This small policy was launched in 2013. It was received quite well. The government promised that it's going to continue. It's good news. Of course, if you apart from taking into account the environment you are in, you also have to consider enhancing your productivity. Nowadays, with advancing technology, you will have to move towards this area. You have to digitalize your business. Of course, in order to survive, they will have to squeeze and cut costs and it is very difficult for them to set aside extra resources to move towards high technology. The FS said that there will be $50 million as a matching fund to subsidize the retail sector to make better use of information technology. If this succeeds, it will drive down operating cost of SMEs, and at the same time it will reduce the burden of work of employees. And if a similar scheme is in place for SMEs in other sectors, it will be even better. Nowadays, people use cloud computing. Enterprises can flexibly use a data bank and software on the internet. This will drive down cost, and they can also use it on multi-platform. It's very good for SMEs, but still SMEs know very little about cloud computing. The administration should promote the use of cloud computing and give them the technology they need so that they can put it to use. I hope the government will announce details as soon as possible so that SMEs who are interested will be able to know about the plan. And I talked about high operating cost and external uncertainties, thereby making it difficult for SMEs to operate. This also deters people from starting their own business. There are a lot of enterprising people in Hong Kong would like to start their business, but it's difficult to start. They don't have the capital. And in the end, they will have to just put their great ideas into the back burner and be content with being just an employee. It's not easy to have innovative ideas, and the only difficulty they encounter is capital. Then this enterprise support program will be beneficial. The government wants to revitalize historical buildings to give the creative industry more space to develop. The idea itself is very good. They encourage people to start their own businesses, and that is a quick way to promote competition. I just hope that the policies will have a wider scope and be more effective. SMEs do their best to come up with the best product, but they need a good platform to launch their products. And they have to build their image so that people will come to them to buy their products and services. If your brand is famous, people will come to you. Otherwise, they don't pay much attention to you, especially in the mainland market. If consumers don't know your brand, then they simply won't patronize you. And still, SMEs don't have money for marketing. They don't have the marketing network, so it's very difficult for them to build their name, their brand. In 2012, there was the Bud Fund to subsidize Hong Kong SMEs to upgrade and build up their brands. It is of great help to SMEs. When it comes to developing the design gallery network, the Trade Development Council provide more sales channel for SMEs to develop different markets. These two initiatives are very important to SMEs. The Working Group on Long-Term Physical Planning submitted the report to the LegCo. They have made recommendations and set out the different scenarios. We are still at an initial stage when it comes to the setting of the future fund. We don't have any details yet. There are suggestions that the future funds should be used on social welfare, education, infrastructure, healthcare, or retirement protection. And I think we need to have further discussions. The FSTB indicated that in due course there will be consultation. Stable financial situation is very important for further development. If, like the CCF, the Community Care Fund, there are so many purses, then it would give the impression that the administration would like to circumvent the LegCo to avoid being monitored. So the government should explain clearly the purpose and the content of the future fund so that the public will have a better understanding of the fund and they will have a better discussion so that consensus can be forged. To be honest, President, I think the budget has reached a passing mark. And I have outlined the government's help to SMEs. In paragraph 101 about the support to SMEs, there is a litany of the different measures. Five of them is only about the continuation or extension of the period. That means that there are five existing measures. I agree that these measures are effective, but I hope that the government can think outside the box to give more help to SMEs. We always expect better. I hope the LegCo members will not just criticize one single point on the budget and negate all the merits in the budget. I so submit to support the budget. Ms. An Chang.